going to shift gears now, and the next up is going to be a look at a sustainment perspective from Army Aviation. And to do that, we have Major General Doug Gabram, the Commanding General of the Army Aviation and Missile Command. And Doug, thank you.
How y'all doing? Hey, wait a minute now in the back. Everybody's running away. Just what I'd like to do is I think we're maybe 20 minutes behind, so I want to make sure my battle buddies, John Evans and Thomas Todd, have the appropriate time. But first, I want to thank just a few people. One, Brigadier General Retired E.J. Sinclair for 2 years of great leadership. Outstanding, and we all know what you put into it, and we appreciate it. And inbound, this is the RIP process. It's like a wedding. You're on this side, you're on this side. Brigadier General Retired Steve Munt is coming on board, and we're going to be blessed with your leadership. I do have to say, though, if you read the Quad A magazine, EJ, your comments about not bad for a Blackhawk guy, so maybe this picture will change in the background, but we'll see what happens. And Bill Harris, I see you sitting there. Thanks for all you've done over the past 100 years and your band of professionals. And the 75th Army Aviation birthday, if you will, pretty special. I would, for all the younger folks in the back, take the Quad A magazine. It's pretty thick this time, but read about our former branch chiefs, command sergeants major, CWOBs, senior officers. Their experiences and their leadership over the past years is why we are where we are today. And, you know, it's funny, there's an old saying, the more things change, the more they stay the same. What's not going to change, and if you've heard it again and again, and I'm very passionate about it, and I think I know it's the reason we exist, is the sacred trust that we have built with the ground commander and the ground soldiers. So at the end of the day, we can talk about FMC rates and LMP and CAMS, and I can acronym you to death. What is the most important thing is we maintain that trust. And all those that have gone before us have fought extremely hard for it, and we need to do the same. So if you draw your attention to this slide, what's on the screen, talk for a second about the six-pack. And as I walk around the world here on this slide, our branch chief, Bill Gaylor, thanks to his leadership, the force and that bond and that trust is and will remain strong. If you come over here, this is our team, the AMCOM team. And yet to talk is Thomas Todd, PEO Aviation, and then our great soft community led by John Evans and Mr. John Shipley. And then in the middle, of course, is you've heard from Eric Peterson. We congratulate him on the job that he's done. And then Frank Tate coming on board. Frank, all I got to say is if I can't see you, that's a beautiful thing about this stage. You can't, so your jokes, you can't even see who the hell's laughing. But your enthusiasm at breakfast, you got to maintain that. So we'll see. We'll check that in about 3 months. So the six-pack, as you see it, the Enterprise is here. And there's maybe a symbol that's not on here that I want to mention. That's Compo 2 and Compo 3, National Guard and Reserve. But that's really the blood that flows through all of us, because all of us, all the organizations, we have Guard and Reserve built into our organization as we move forward, because we know we can't do it without you. So what I'd like to do now is there's a question that commanders often get is, what keeps you up at night? And I'm going to show you a video here, not that this was coordinated with General Francis, but we all know that the threat, and you've heard about it again and again, but maybe you missed this 60-minute presentation by General Brooks. And as many of us have commented, and General Schlosser just said it, Iraq and Afghanistan, we will sustain that for a foreseeable future at some level. And if you had a crystal ball, one might say we may increase there. And we also have this interesting conflict to the west called Syria. But the two, what is different, I think, for all of you, as you, for this Quad A and maybe the past two, specifically this one, is the near-peer competitor threat that we face in our world. And you've heard great presentations from Frank Tate and Dave Francis on both of those. So this is a little odd. I know I'm the AMCOM commander. I'm going to show this video, and then I'm going to tell you why. But if you could please roll this.
This was no Cold War theme park. Body armor was required, and artillery was on standby in the event we came under fire.
Vince Hello, Brooks. General.
Nice
How are
to see you?
You. Very nice to meet you.
All right.
General Vincent Brooks has commanded U.S. forces fighting in Iraq and Afghanistan.
I don't think people at home know how tense this line is.
What it takes to go from the condition we're in at this moment to hostilities again is literally the matter of a decision on North Korea's side to say fire. And on top of this, we have the missile capability that's been developed. Over 120 missiles fired just in the time of Kim Jong-un alone.
So now they're talking about ICBMs that might be able to reach the west coast of the United States. How do you stop them from taking that next step?
North Korea is responsible for the direction that the region is going. It is responsible for the conditions of instability that are starting to arise. It has to take responsibility for that and stop.
His country is poor, his people are starving. What is it that he wants?
Survival and recognition.
Kim Jong-un is now recognized as a global threat. U.S. intelligence estimates he has at least 10 nuclear weapons. If the U.S. decided it had no choice but to launch a preemptive strike on an ICBM test site, it could trigger the unthinkable.
If North Korea uses nuclear weapons, it will be met with an effective and overwhelming response. And they can take it to the bank. We make that same point to our allies and partners like the Republic of Korea, like Japan.
Effective and overwhelming response.
Effective and overwhelming response.
Wipe North Korea off the map.
Whatever overwhelms you.
So whatever overwhelms you. These aren't my notes. I want to get to this here in a second. So I think what I want to, if next slide, please. What I want to get at off of that is my other portfolio is the missile portfolio. And I had a chance to, just like we do with our team and the aviation team, meet with the ADA commanders frequently. And as I, every morning at 6, 6.05 and 6.15, and my wife's very familiar with it, BlackBerry goes off and I get a status of all the aviation and missile readiness rates around the world for all MDSs in aviation deployed here in CONUS and then missile also, HIMARS, THAAD, Patriot, et cetera. What I found out is, and what was interesting is, of course, the missile readiness is very, very high, which is good news. But when you start asking some questions and you peel the onion back or go behind the curtain in terms of maybe some key parts that are zero balance, or are we ready not only to fight tonight but fight tomorrow, the answers are maybe for a lot of reasons not what you would want to hear. So I have the same concern, quite frankly, with Army Aviation. Now we're getting after it, we're working hard. And as you can see in this slide, this backdrop, grayscale slide, you can't read it, but that's the branch vision, that's where we're going. I would say fight tonight, when you hear General Milley talk about readiness, what he really means in plain English is, can we fight tonight? And as you just heard the past two presentations, it's really important. So used to be a motto called mission first, soldier always. So I kind of substituted fight tonight, sustain always. Because as we know, in Desert Shield, Desert Storm, OIF-1, we pushed hard in the beginning, our resiliency, how long could we stay on the battlefield? All of you might have a different opinion on that. So not bad for the first shot, not bad for the first deep attack, but can we sustain ourselves in an austere environment? So that would be the question, and that is what we're after. So our campaign plan in AMCOM, linked to the CSA and the AMC priorities, talks about, if you had to ask me what we do, that's develop and deliver material readiness for Army Aviation in order to meet the Army requirements. These are Army requirements over here. Extremely important. So we've talked about, you've heard many over the past 24 hours talk about these bullets here. What if the port's contested? What if we can't get into the port? How do we mobility? Essentially, what I think you would all agree, FOB culture right now, You know, where's the refrigerator? Where's my stuff? I need two Chinooks to move a whatever, put it, you know, fill in the blanks. It is not going to be like that in a Europe fight or a Korean fight or maybe pick another fight. So how are we getting after that? How do we sustain a prolonged fight? And this right here concerns a lot of us. General Gaylor and I were just over in Europe, and we observed Lieutenant Colonel Ryan Welch conduct a gunnery at Grath, and the field craft, I'm talking about shooting here, I'm talking about field craft and sustainability, the things that he were doing was back to the future, maybe some of us 25, 30 years ago, and that's where we need to be. You heard General Tate make the comment about camouflage green, like we don't have those. That's what we got to get back towards. So if I talk sustainability on that piece in general, let's go to the next slide. Something that we've done that we're pretty proud of as a team, as a branch, is a new Army sustainment strategy. We've been working on this for about 8 months because we pumped the brakes, to be quite honest, because we were waiting for the Holistic Aviation Assessment Task Force review to come out, because there are several things that we wanted to synchronize. But what's important here, what I want to highlight, in supporting us, is you see Gaylor, Gabram, and Todd on the signature line. So all of us, it's a strategic document, and it's nested to the branch modernization and training strategy, which is extremely important. But you can see in the middle here, those are the required attributes that the branch chief is leading us through. All are extremely important. All these words have very distinct meanings, as he has talked about, reach, protection, lethality. We touch all of those in AMCOM, but obviously our focus is on sustainability. So if you open this document, and it's not a 150-page read, actually, it's about 25 pages, these are the objectives that we're after. There's five lines of effort. My intent is not to go into this here. There's five lines of effort, but what's important is we've fixed responsibility for those lines of effort and linked them to a governance process. For example, PEO Aviation has one line. Fort Rucker, DOTD has two lines of effort. AMCOM, we have ours. And then DAG4 has the fifth line, all shooting towards these five objectives. Now, the vignette I'd like to take you through and how we get after this, that I can simplify this. So we were, General Gaylor and I, we were on a trip about 3 weeks ago, and Sergeant Major Chambers and Mr. Rowland to visit the 10th CAB. So we were fortunate enough, because of all Bill's contacts, quite frankly, to visit Latvia. We went to Romania. We went to Ilisheim, Kotterbach. We did not get to Turkey, but we saw Claire Gill's spread of, you know, his tyranny of distance challenge, like Frank pointed out, and the mission command challenge. So let's talk about how do we reduce soldier burden, improve this, reduce log footprint. What we're going to do, and this is linked to scheduled maintenance program on HADF number 39 review, we are going to increase the PMI for the UH-60 by 120 hours, both PMIs. 120 hours. What's that going to do? And why did it take us a long time to do that? And the credit goes to the PM, Billy Jackson, and the AMRDAC team under Mr. Jeff Langout. This has taken a while. But I'll tell you what it does if you peel that onion back. Remember the distances that Frank talked about, where everybody's at? A company in Latvia, we're spread all over the place. Now, we don't have to pull that PMI 1 and 2. We're 120 hours to the good. We've done the analysis. We think it's the right thing to do, and we're going to implement in about 30 to 45 days. So we've reduced soldier burden. We've improved operational availability, and we reduced our log footprint because we can't pull a phase up forward, at least right now, in Latvia, for example. So that's the nesting. That's the correlation. That's the operationalizing of this strategy along with some of the HADF recommendations. Let's go to the next slide. So there it is on the left, the Holistic Aviation Assessment Task Force study report led by General Mangum. There were 63 recommendations. I will tell you, this report is now strategic objective number one under the Army campaign plan, which is, we think, good for the branch. Look at the name, Regaining Decisive Action Readiness. This report's been looked at. Hey, this is not only a good aviation thing, let's do it for other branches. that's being looked at. So the two HADF recommendations I want to briefly touch on is 38 and 39. One has to do with schedule maintenance program, looking at our scheduled maintenance intervals. Do we have them right? I gave you just a quick vignette about that. But conditions-based maintenance. If I took a survey in the audience, everybody probably has an opinion on conditions-based maintenance and what you think and what you think it isn't. I would tell you that we have done, and many are vested in the audience on this, over the past 12 and 13, 14 years, we've done a good job here for the hardware piece. We've invested a lot of OCO money on each airframe. I think we could all agree on that. 91% of our aircraft right now in the fleet, all three compos, have digital collectors on them right now. What is that data telling us? What I think we're trying to do and move forward, and oh, by the way, this is draft, conditions-based maintenance strategy, and you can see the big patch in the middle there. And when we get this synchronized, all three of us will sign this, just similar to what we did on the sustainment strategy. But we weren't, over the past, we were stovepipe for all the right reasons, not to debate that here, but we weren't synchronized and we didn't institutionalize it. If you go down Dotlam PF and you evaluate where we're at on CBM, well, you know, we didn't train it in the 128th. We didn't train it there. So we have pockets of excellence in the Army. The 160th is very good at it. South Carolina Guard is very good at it. Some units are very good at it, but we're not synchronized. So here's the tactical vignette on CBM. Aircraft is in a combat zone and has a transmission chips light. The crew executes the appropriate emergency procedure, but CBM, those sensors on the aircraft, and there's a couple other things we have to have going on, but a message is sent to the battalion production control, information flows back, and it's a transducer. We don't have chips in the main transmission. It's a transducer. Now the chain of command can accurately measure the risk. If we can make it back to the FOB or wherever we're coming from, fine. One-time flight, now we can make a better recommendation now that we know what we're dealing with. Or the helicopter is on the ground and we employ the right DART capability and maintenance capability so we don't put soldiers on the ground at risk in a combat zone unnecessarily, and we got, you know, 25 infantry, et cetera, and we find out it's a transducer later, and then all of a sudden we bring all this other stuff and parts. You see what I mean? That's the tactical application of CBM, and that's why it's important. When I was chief of staff in the first CAV, we lost an aircraft extortion 17, two SEAL teams, very bad day. Maybe some of you remember that. The rest of the story is, in the same 24-hour period, we had three other aircraft on the ground. So RC East and a division front, the resources that the division commander had to apply to secure that, little did we know, two of those aircraft, really, if we would have understood the P-4T3 and CBM would have helped us understand what we were dealing with, we wouldn't have had to employ that many soldiers on the ground to protect those aircraft, and we would have done our business a heck of a lot more efficiently, for example, tactical. So if you bump CBM up to the operational and strategic, what do we have to do? We have 13 years worth of CBM data and all Zay data in a cloud. I'm still trying to find it, but I pay for it. We have this data, but what does it mean? If you don't put together useful data, what do you have? We're going to migrate that data to LOGSA. That's another story. But we have to, as an enterprise, we have to strategically figure out CBM, and we have some good ideas. But the way ahead, the start is getting everybody on the same sheet of music, moving in the same direction, and that's what the branch chief wants, and that's where we're moving forward in CBM. We're pretty excited. And I know many of you have ideas on CBM, and we'd be glad to listen to them. Next slide. Last slide. What I'd like to make you aware of in terms of, I'm sorry, go back to that. So I mentioned it before, but a mission command realignment order in Army Material Command happened about a year ago, and we were very privileged to get AMRDEC, Aviation Missile Research Development Engineering Center, and the Army Contracting Command, OPCON, to AMCOM. And that's kind of right here. So what's the so what of that? The power of that is, as we look at developing building two premier weapon systems. One is multi-mission launcher, has to do in the missile world, but the other is the UH-60 Victor. It's really important. We just had General Milley at Huntsville about a week and a half ago, and we showed him these two efforts, weapon systems, and where we're at in terms of milestone and why we think they're a little bit different. And here's why. Because these are government designed, integrated, and hopefully produced at CCAD. And I'm talking about the UH-60 Victor. So if you back that up a second, you look at this. So I'm the supporting command for the PEO, Thomas Todd. I'm the supporting, but we own all this. So the contracting piece, the supply chain management on that aircraft, the production control at CCAD, 760 of those aircraft, and the engineering testing we own. I told the boss, I said, hey, if it fails, it's on me. If it's successful, we clap for the PEO and obviously the soldiers on the ground. But this is the difference. So we are, the government essentially is the OEM. Now, that's not to say there's multiple industry connections here, public-private partnerships, because there's many, as you know. But that's what's different about that, and we think it's an acquisition game changer because we can reduce cost, we can reduce timeline, and we will own most of the general purpose data rights, which equates to tech data package. We think this is a good thing. If I come down to the bottom part of the chart here, the AMC commander, General Gus Perna, has charged us with 100% supply availability. Now, you think we can achieve that? We're driving hard. Right now, we're about 80%, give or take, on MDSs. Blackhawk's about 74, Apache's maybe 69, Chinook, I don't know, 72 plus or minus. We got a lot of work to do here, but we are on it. We are more coordinated with DLA than we've ever have. Obviously, the aviation is called B-17 parts, but the sources of supply, we've changed our battle rhythm, so I'll dummy it down just a little bit. We're having an old PC meeting, and we're running parts with all the suppliers, and we're figuring out how many backorder, and the suppliers means most of the folks on the floor out there. And we're running the backorder trace. We've had a backorder on a part for 3 years, and why the heck do we still have it? Get rid of it, make the call. That's my call, we're done with it. So we're reducing back orders. Inventory, excess inventory, we're driving hard. That's one of General Perna's pet peeves. If I told you the dollar amount, you wouldn't believe it. Forecast accuracy, and I'll just come back to CCAD for a second. Corpus Christi, Colonel Allen said, is in the audience. We talked a little bit about yesterday, but we are doing things differently at Corpus because we've pulled in a program called Art of the Probable. It used to be possible, but that's Air Force, so it's going to be probable now. But what our goal is to reduce repair cycle time, because it takes too long to do a Blackhawk. We want to get that down to about 275 days. And it's a gate strategy based on the theory of constraints, and we have business rules, strict business rules. We've established what they call supercells on the floor between production and supply, kind of like a talk jock atmosphere, and we've given authority to the right people. We're excited about it. It's going to take time, but we're pushing hard. Why? Reduce repair cycle time so we can bring this on board. And we're fired up about it. So, path forward, how we're getting at this. I've talked a little bit about battle rhythm, and it's not only battle rhythm inside Army Material Command, but it's with the branch, it's with external vendors, which is really important, and come back here, ACCR and AMRDEC, us being together now, OPCON, is very important, and we've seen a lot of progress. So with that, I have expedited because I want to save time for my two battle buddies. If you can go to the last slide, I want to put a paid announcement to our team because I know a lot of the work and the real work gets done outside. And I'm very serious about how to get approved for this TDY because General Perna says, what is the output? You're going, what is the output for your visit? So our team, Command Sergeant Major Mike O'Donnell, who just took over about 5 days ago, all the hard questions go to him. And by the way, many of you know Command Sergeant Major Glenn Vila sitting there, just retired after 32 years of service last week. So if you get a chance, congratulate him. CW5 Leon Cardona, basically our CWAB is here. Colonel Al Lancetta is running around, the CCAD commander. Colonel Mike Best, ACLC, at Fort Rucker, who really works for, has two bosses, has two stars, and he's really fired up about that. Colonel Sean Prickett, our chief of staff, just replaced Brigadier General Todd Royer, who's going to be the ADCS in the 101st here in a couple days. I'm trying to get in the trunk, but he won't let me. Colonel Dave Almquist, our G5, and Colonel Andy Ginlett, our deputy for the Aviation Logistics Center, over 2,000 folks. That's who does supply chain, so please corner him. And then the acting director of AmerDeck, Mr. Jeff Langhout, is also here. And again, back to this, so that's why you see us moving as a group, as a pack. Some people don't like that, that's okay. But the branch chief, myself, the PEO, AmerDeck, Damo AV, you see us, there's a reason for that. So the force is strong, and I'm proud and really humbled to be part of this team. So with that, I'll get off the stage and turn it back to General Schlosser.